Do you serve a great God? Can anybody testify with the choir and say, great is the Lord? I don't know if you think he's great because he's healed you. I don't know if you think he's great because he delivered you, or if you think he's great because he changed you, or if you think he's great because he's rearranged you, or maybe you think he's great because he's soothed you, or he's counseled you, or he strengthened you, or solidified you. Maybe you think he's great because he saved you. But for whatever the reason, I think we can all agree that our God is a great God and worthy to be praised. Not just great because he puts food on the table and clothes on our backs and a roof over our head, but great because he stepped down from on high and stretched his arms far and wide and said, if I can't live with them, I don't want to live without them. My God is great and greatly to be praised. Does anybody just want to praise the Lord in this place? Anybody want to say that he's a good God? He's a merciful God. He's a wonderful God. He's a marvelous God. He's a transforming God. He's a delivering God. He's a healing God. He's a victorious God. He's a salvation-giving God. He's a remembering his promises God. He's a saving Buck Fordham God. He's a coming back to get us God. He's a great God, a great God, a great God, a great God. Let everything that hath breath praise ye the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let's exalt his name together. If you know he's a great God, just stand on your feet. And between you and God, just thank him for being a great God. Thank him for being a saving God. Thank him for being a prayer answering God. Thank him for being a delivering God. Thank him for being a forgiving God. Just say, great God, worthy to be praised. Why don't you just worship him in this place? Oh, dear Heavenly Father, we've come into this house to praise you. And we are so thankful that you inhabit the praises of your people. So, Lord, we're asking that as we open your word, that you would speak to our hearts. Oh, Father, we need a word from the Lord. So hover over me, Holy Spirit. Bathe my trembling heart and brow. Fill me with your hallowed presence. Come, oh, come and fill me now. Fill me now, fill me now. Only you can fill me now. So fill me with your hallowed presence. Come, please come and fill us now. In the name of Jesus, let the church of the living God say amen. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. It is a blessing to be here with you in this place on this day. I am so honored to have been invited to come back home and to share a word from the Lord. I want to thank these, my pastoral colleagues, for the invitation. I thought to myself, I was -2 when Pastor Gabe Taylor started preaching. We praise the Lord for Gabe Taylor and Pastor James White and these gentlemen upon whose shoulders we stand. And we are thankful that God never runs out of finding people who will share the good news of salvation. And we praise the Lord for a new generation of preachers who are continuing to keep that torch lit. Once again, I'm thankful to the individuals for this invitation. They told me that the theme is pretty much just the gospel. I don't know how they tried to word it or fancy it or phrase it. And to tell you the truth, I didn't care. The moment I heard the gospel, I really wasn't listening about anything else. And I said, just tell me when to be there, and I've got to come. I've gotten to a point where I really don't want to talk about anything else. I'm becoming a one-trick pony, you know? But it dawned on me that Paul said, I decided to know nothing among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified. So I feel like I might be in good company. So let me just tell you in advance, if you're tired of hearing the gospel, if you're tired of the same old story, you might as well go ahead and get in the lunch line. But if perchance you want to hear more about your Savior, if perchance you want to hear more about your Redeemer, if perchance you want to hear the good news that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us, then I invite you to give me your attention. I shared on last evening that my church is sick and tired of every Kansas City Royal and Kansas City Chief illustration. So it's good to be in a place that accepts me as I am and doesn't mind me just celebrating every now and then. I told them they just jealous, you know. They just jealous. I tell you this, I am not only thankful to be back in this place, I'm thankful that the Lord has allowed my sons to even get a little bit of Kansas City by osmosis. It was my oldest son who named his dog KC. They don't even like the Titans, man. I tried to help them like the Titans. And no, we Chiefs fans, you know. I do want to bring you all greetings from Walter and Shirley Fordham. Now, something's wrong with my father. He wears his Steelers jersey a little too much, a little too often. So we have to remind him, but they are doing well in Atlanta and wanted me to tell you hello. Have you ever expected something to be good? I mean, anticipated that thing being good. Have you ever dreamed about something being good? Have you ever believed that something would be good? But then when you finally experienced it, it was worse than you believed. Have you ever had that kind of experience? I remember when my family, we went to the Holy Land experience. I don't know if you're familiar with it. It's a theme park in Orlando, a Christian theme park. Now, maybe it's a whole lot better now, but we went in the first year of their operation. Now, we had been spending the week at Disney World, so we figured come Sabbath, we're going to go to the Christian theme park. I'm assuming that they're going to have a ride where you go down into the water and end up inside of the belly of a whale and you're projected out after 3 days or so. I'm thinking that maybe you'll be in another ride that's like the Ark and you're shaking to and fro. I'm thinking that maybe they'll have some kind of situation where you're experiencing what it would be like to actually be crucified and to come up out of the grave or something. And all they had was some little mamby-pamby little loaves that you could eat, and they had some little fish that you could taste, and they had some little water things here, and they talking about how Jesus and the disciples were on the... It was so much worse than I believed it would be. Now, on the other hand, have you ever expected something to be good? Anticipated that thing being good, dreamed about that thing being good, imagined that thing being good, believing that thing to be good, and when you experienced it, it was better than you believed? See, I happen to be one of these brothers who took Jesus's counsel about saving yourself for marriage seriously. So on August 25th, 1996, almost 20 blessed years ago, when it dawned on me near the end of that ceremony, after we had fraternized and exchanged cake and engaged in the throwing of garters and the throwing of bouquets, that the moment we leave, I can enjoy myself. And I'm here to let you know, I was anticipating that thing, dreaming of that thing, preparing for that thing. Can I go on? Can I go on? Believing that that thing would be good. And that thing was better than I first believed. I want you to know that the title of our subject today is Better Than I Believed. Y'all, I have been reintroduced to the gospel of Jesus Christ. And the more that I study this thing and analyze this thing and dissect this thing and get into this thing and swim around this thing and masticate on this thing, I'm realizing that it's better than I first believed. I thought that it would be good. I imagined that it would be good. I anticipated it being good. But I'm here to tell you the good news of salvation by grace through faith in Jesus Christ is even better than I believed. I want to talk about a woman who found out firsthand that the gospel was even better than she believed. Her story is in John chapter 8. The context is the Feast of Tabernacles. It was one of the three great feasts when all of the Jews would make a pilgrimage to Jerusalem. It was akin to like our alumni weekends, and people are commuting and traveling and making their way back to the Mecca, back to Jerusalem. But this year was extra special. There was a little more excitement in the air because words had been going out on the street about this dude named Jesus. He was giving sight to the blind. He was unplugging the ears of the deaf. He's telling the lame to walk and the dumb to talk. And the word was that he actually raised some people from the dead. People were coming to the conclusion that this guy was God. As they are journeying to Jerusalem, Jesus is trending on the tongue of every caravan. Everybody is either declaring faith in him or denouncing him or defending him or debating about him. But regardless of your ideology, everybody was desperately hoping to see him. Jesus was a first century rock star. And the rise of Jesus' popularity was getting on the last nerve of the scribes and the Pharisees. They were not only jealous at the increase of his influence, but they were irritated at the decline of theirs. And they were just looking for an opportunity to embarrass this young dude and burst his popularity bubble. That's why John chapter 8 verse 6 says that they were trying to trap him in order that they might have evidence to accuse him. So they interrupt his presentation and bring a lady on stage who was caught in adultery. Now, don't miss this next part. In the very Now, I understand that everyone ages 4 to 12 is in a different building, so we got a PG-13 audience. They busted her in the very act. This is not gossip. This is not innuendo, hearsay, third party. No, they bring this woman in the middle of divine worship without even giving her an opportunity to cover herself or clothe herself. She is there probably with some sheets dangling, and they bring her before Jesus. They caught her in the very act. What an unfeeling, insensitive, disrespectful practice. How dare they parade this woman along with her sins and her shame and set her in the midst of the congregation for everyone to stare at her and scowl at her and glare at her and gawk at her. Where do we get this Christian form of hazing? I'm so thankful that we didn't get it from Jesus. Oh, no, no, no. My Bible tells me that we have a high priest who can be touched with the feelings of our infirmities. He was in all points tempted like as we are, but yet without sin. That means he understands us and gets us and feels us, and he relates to us. But never does he do anything to unnecessarily wound us or shame us or humiliate us. Even when Jesus must rebuke, he does it in love. What did the hymn writer say? Does Jesus care when I've tried and failed to resist some temptation strong, when for my deep grief there is no relief, though my tears flow all the night long? Oh, yes, he cares. I know he cares. His heart is touched with my grief. When the days are weary and the long nights are dreary, I know my Savior cares. Jesus cares, and Jesus cared. And the scribes and Pharisees knew it. So they figured that that's exactly what they would exploit. See, they were aware of the softer side of Jesus. They had heard Jesus talking about this gospel of the kingdom, and whosoever will, let him come. They knew that with Jesus there was no discrimination between high or low or rich or poor or educated or uneducated or Jew or Gentile. They knew that Jesus was overboard in sharing this gospel of grace. And they also knew that Jesus knew that not only could he be gracious, he also had to be just. See, as far as they were concerned, Jesus' gospel was watered down. It was dumbed down. It was milky with no meat. And they felt like it lacked substance. Jesus didn't speak about the law enough. Jesus didn't speak about the standards enough. Jesus didn't speak about the old pillars of the church enough. Jesus didn't deal with jewelry enough. And Jesus didn't deal with all of this, you know, concern about whether or not we can sing this kind of music enough. And Jesus didn't preach enough sermons about the Sabbath and the state of the dead. Jesus was going soft, and he was always talking about grace. And they knew that he knew that God was also just. And if he communicated grace, it could not be at the expense of God's law. So they would take advantage of Jesus's penchant for grace and show how his brand of the gospel failed at upholding the law. Do you understand where they are? They are trying to show how Jesus's gospel does not maintain the law. So pretending to seek his wisdom and respect his authority, they say to him with their half-naked evidence in tow, "A teacher, this woman was caught in adultery. I mean, we wish that she hadn't been, and we're sorry that we got to deal with this and bring it to your attention. But Moses actually says that she must be stoned. What do you say?" They know that Jesus wants to be gracious and forgiving, but they also know that he must communicate a righteousness that upholds the demands of God's sacred law. Emphasizing grace alone is insufficient. God may be gracious, but God is also holy and just. And don't we have the same understanding of God? We expect God to be just. I'm looking forward to "Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord, I will repay." We expect God to correct some things and fix some things and legislate some things and respond to some things. We expect him to deal with all of the economic inequality and the religious intolerance and the racial discrimination. We expect God to be just. We expect him to deal with sinners and sin and establish a kingdom of righteousness. We expect God to be just. So if Jesus is preaching a gospel of grace and it does not maintain God's justice, it must be cast aside. Now don't get it twisted. Jesus was not caught off guard. He's immediately aware of their pretended religiosity and Pharisaical hypocrisy. Jesus is aware of the whole charade. He reads this like an old newspaper. "Moses in the law commanded us that she should be stoned." Well, Moses said that the man and the woman should be stoned. Where's the dude? Wouldn't it be just to bring him to? Oh, maybe he's already here. Maybe he's one of the very ones bringing the accusation. Oh, Jesus knows exactly what's going on. He realizes that this is between him and the teachers of the law, and the woman is just caught in the line of fire. Jesus sees her fear. He's taking note of every tear. He feels the guilt, the embarrassment, the humiliation, the shame with every fiber of his being. He relates to her pain. But the scribes and Pharisees are correct. Jesus has to be just. So look what he does. In John 8, verse 6, they said this to trap him, trying to accuse him of not maintaining the justice of God's law. So Jesus stoops down, and he starts writing with his finger on the ground. Now, we don't have a lot of evidence of Jesus writing. Matter of fact, the only thing you might appeal to is if you see him as the angel of the covenant that was that spiritual rock that followed the children of Israel in their journeyings through the wilderness, you might say that he wrote the Ten Commandment law with his own finger. But beyond this, we have nothing else that Jesus has written. So if Jesus is writing, if the Word who became flesh is writing a word, I know I'd like to peek and have a look-see. You know, I got a hair of nosiness and curiosity, and obviously they did too. Because the next thing the Bible says is Jesus says, whoever is without sin among you, let him be the first to cast a stone. And when they heard it, they dropped their stones and left, from the eldest to the least. Had some old elders out there. This was first century internet porn. They checking it out. But they also are checking out what Jesus has written. And there's something about what Jesus has written that when they heard it, yes, they heard him say, whoever's without sin among you, let him cast a stone first. But remember, these are Pharisees. These are the kind of people who think they are without sin. So if Jesus says, whoever's without sin, let him cast the first stone, they would pick up a stone, get in line, and say, here I am. But there's something about what they heard. I think what Jesus wrote spoke louder than what he said. And they heard it. They also heard the gasp that would go throughout the congregation if Jesus read what he wrote. They were comfortable parading this woman and her sins in front of everybody, but they were horrified at the thought that Jesus might parade theirs too. So they drop the stones and jet. And then the Bible says that Jesus raises himself up, says to the woman, woman, where are those accusers of yours? Has no one condemned you? When the woman first heard Jesus say, whoever is without sin, let him be the first to cast a stone, she thought that was her death sentence. Her head is bowed and she's bracing for the stones to come. But the next thing she hears is Jesus saying, where are your accusers? She lifts up her head, looks around, and realizes everybody's gone. She's by herself. There's a feeling of relief, and there's a gasp of joy and appreciation. She thought her life was gone, but then it dawns on her, she's not alone. Jesus is still here. And remember, Jesus said, whoever among you is without sin, let him be the first to cast a stone. Jesus could pick up a stone. The reality is that there is only one being in the entire universe who fits the job description that Jesus laid out. And to this woman's potential horror, that one person is still here. Jesus said, whoever is without sin, let him cast the first stone. Oh, the Bible says all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But that is accepting one, the Holy One, the one who said, who among you convicts me of sin? The one who said, the prince of this world cometh and he has nothing in me. Jesus
is the only one in all the universe who could pick up a stone, and he's standing right here. Not only could he pick up a stone, Jesus should pick up a stone. If Jesus lets this thing go, we'll have immorality running rampant. Jesus would be seconding her action if he turns a blind eye. You can't just ignore the standards of God's law. Not only could Jesus pick up a stone, I'm arguing that Jesus should pick up a stone. This woman, regardless of the circumstances or situation, she participated in sin. She's responsible for all of the marital discord, the infidelity, the divorce, the broken homes, children being raised in single parent families. She's responsible for the crime that results, for all the chaos and decadence. She has broken God's law, and the wage of sin is death. Jesus could pick up a stone, and Jesus should pick up a stone. But if he did, he wouldn't be gracious. Do you see the dilemma? Jesus so desperately wants to be gracious, but Jesus must also be righteous and just. So what does Jesus do? The Bible says that Jesus asked her, "Woman, where are your accusers? Has anyone condemned you?" She says, "No one, Lord," as if to say, "Will you?" And notice what Jesus says, "Neither do I condemn you." I've never understood why we fancy ourselves as followers of Jesus, but we are so quick to condemn, so quick to catch sin, so quick to publicly put it in front of the church as if our role designated by God is to purify the church. And yet Jesus himself said, "Neither do I condemn you." But even though I may like that and enjoy that, I still have to question that. How could Jesus simply say, "Neither do I condemn you"? Did he just ignore the righteousness of God's law? Did he make it void? Did Jesus get cold feet? Was he from St. Louis and he got scurred? Jesus can't handle his business? Does a woman have some associates with political influence and he's concerned about recourse and reputation? What did you? Don't get me wrong. I'm not pulling for her execution, but I just thought Jesus had to execute justice. So what happened? The Bible is trying to communicate that Jesus simultaneously executed grace and justice by proclaiming the gospel. What happened? The gospel happened. Understand this. When Jesus said, "Listen to me, neither do I condemn you," he said it not because he was throwing away the law, not because he was poo-pooing righteousness, not because he was against the standards. Jesus said, neither do I condemn you, because instead of condemning her, he condemned himself. The good news of the gospel is that instead of justly, righteously condemning us, Jesus willingly condemned himself. That's why he is both just and the justifier of those who believe in him. The good news of the gospel is that Jesus condemned himself. In other words, 2 Corinthians 5:19 says, God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not counting people's trespasses against them. How did he not count it against them? Because he counted it against him. He, God, made him, Jesus, who knew no sin, to be sin for us, instead of us, on behalf of us. Jesus paid our penalty. We went to dinner at a 5-star restaurant with no wallet, no credit card, and no job. And we put a tab up the size of Mount Everest, and Jesus came in and paid our bill. The good news of the gospel is that Christ was condemned, killed, crucified for us, instead of us, in place of us. When the Bible says Jesus condemned sin in the flesh, Romans 8 verse 3, he didn't just proclaim that sin in humanity was condemned. This wasn't just an announcement of some public service announcement of somebody in some city proclaiming that a building is condemned. No, he took on a body and he condemned it. Jesus took every sin like a superhero, absorbed it in his own self, and took it to the cross and buried it in the grave. He became sin for us. That's why Moses put a serpent on that pole rather than a star or a crown or some elevated symbol, because Jesus became sin for us. That's the good news. But remember, I told you, it's better than I believed. Did you all notice that Jesus condemned himself instead of condemning the woman, and she didn't even confess? I need y'all to let that sink in. I know that y'all like preaching, but you need to receive some teaching for a second. Jesus condemned himself instead of condemning her. Said, neither do I condemn you. And she didn't confess. We have this philosophy that in order to get forgiveness, I must first provide some confession. But the problem with that philosophy is it makes salvation dependent on me. If I confess, then God forgives. as if I am the initiator and God is the responder. But no. The Bible is teaching that in the absence of my initiation, when I had no ability to do an initiation, the Bible says at just the right time, in due time, in the nick of time, when we were yet without the strength, powerless, we had lost our cotton picking mind, had no interest in God, no inclination toward God, no desire for God, no taste for God, no interest in God, no feeling for God. But while, I don't know much about the English language, but while means at the same time, concurrent with. While we were planning our sin, while we were tasting the nectar of illicit affairs, while we were in the midst of our foolishness and mayhem, while we were doing our sin, He was executing our salvation. We didn't ask because we didn't even care. The nerve of you to think that your action predates God's action and produces God's action. Oh, but preacher, I've read in the notes of my Bible that this story isn't in every portion of Scripture. It's in the later manuscripts. Maybe it's an addition. Maybe it's incorrect. Well, then go back to Genesis. I think that's in every Bible. When did Adam and Eve confess? These dudes are standing before God in fig leaf righteousness. They standing before God talking about, we think we okay. We okay. We all right, God. No, everything is straight. That's like when Scoog and I were baseball in the house, broke my mother's vase and tried to tape it together. And when she came home, we tried to have a look of everything straight. That is what our puny righteousness looks like. The Bible says even our righteousness is filthy rags. Now, don't confuse it. He didn't say even your raunchiness is filthy rags. You knew your raunchiness was filthy rags. You knew that your lusting and conniving and gossiping and stealing God's money and talking about the pastor and all of that junk, you knew your raunchiness was filthy rags. But he said, your righteousness. You mean even your Sabbath keeping is filthy rags? Your little Ellen White quoting stuff, you know what I'm saying? See, the problem with inviting somebody who's from it, I know y'all Negroes, even your little vegetarian stuff, your little abstaining from extracurricular activities and entertainment and cosmetics and all of that crap. That's what Paul called it. My righteousness is dung. Our righteousness is filthy rags. How could our righteousness provoke and create and incite and initiate God's response? No. The good news of the gospel is that Jesus' act predates ours while we were yet sinners. Didn't he teach it in the Old Testament sanctuary service? Oh, yes, they had animals that they would place their hand over and they would confess their sins and slay the animal, but that was after there was already a morning sacrifice and an evening sacrifice that they had nothing to do with. They did not bring it. They didn't confess over it. It was just provided by a loving high priest. The Bible is trying to teach that God is the initiator. God is the mover. For God so loved the world that he gave. Not after you came to church. Not after you stopped drinking. Not after you stopped smoking. Why we think people got to clean themselves up before they join the church and get in the baptismal pool? Jesus said, even if you could clean yourself up, it would be filthy rags. Our confusion is that we think we are earning brownie salvation points. When the Bible is clear, Jesus saves first and foremost without us.
So you're asking, well, what about 1 John 1:9? If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. It suggests, preacher, that if we do this, then he'll do that. The Greek word for confession in 1 John 1:9 is a word called aphiemi. It means to separate or send away. It's used when Jesus sends the multitude away. He separates them from himself. It's also used when a man divorces his wife. He puts her away. He separates her. This is actually illustrating what I want to call the second phase of forgiveness. When Jesus separates our sins from us, when he cleanses us and washes us. But that ain't the only word for forgiveness. See, there's another word called charizomai. It has the root word of charis. It means grace. You find it in Luke chapter 7 when Jesus told this parable to Simon the leper. He said, one guy owed 500 denarii and another one owed 50. And because both of them couldn't pay, the master just freely forgave them all. He just charizomai'd them. He just went ahead and said, don't worry about it. I got it. I'll take care of it. They didn't ask. They didn't show any kind of bank account. Didn't show that they had enough land to be able to pay back the loan. He just freely forgave them. Charizomai. It also shows up in Colossians 2 verse 13. Turn there with me if you would. In Colossians 2 verse 13, the Bible is interestingly clear. It says in Colossians 2 verses 13 and 14, you were dead because of your sins. Now y'all know the state of the dead. Dead. The dead know not anything. Dead. You can't respond. You can't initiate. You can't confess. Dead. You were dead because of your sins and because of your sinful nature was not yet cut away. Then God made you alive with Christ, for he charizomai'd all our sins, canceling the record of the charges against us and took it away, nailing it to the cross. See, the Bible is trying to teach that the first move starts with God. Doesn't Romans chapter 2 verse 7 say it's the goodness of God that leads us to repentance? Doesn't 1 John chapter 4 say we love him because he first loved us? Jesus freely charizomize us when we don't deserve it, when we couldn't afford it, when we barely understood it. But when we find ourselves like that woman caught in adultery, realizing that the payment is our life, and we see that he gave his life, it moves us in response to say, separate me from my sins, oh God. Please create within me a clean heart, oh God, and renew a steadfast. Wash, oh wash your sons and daughters. It moves us to request his second phase. It's more akin to sanctification. It has moved us to desire for sin to be separated, and he washes us and cleanses us. Oh, yes, after you've come to an awareness that God loved you before you loved him, and you admit your sins. You agree with God concerning your sins. You confess your sins, he's faithful and just to forgive you of your sins, to separate them from you, and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. The gospel is better than we believe. God's original first cause forgiveness predated our confession. He just did it because he loves us. Yes, there is a place in the holistic salvation process for confession and repentance. Yes, there is a place for faith and belief. Yes, there is a place for obedience and works of righteousness, but they are all after. They are in response to God's initial first class, first cause act of salvation. What changes you and rearranges you is the amazing awareness that God would love you. That is the gospel. But not only, I told you it's better than I believe. Not only does God's act predate our confession, when you accept God's act, when you believe God's act, it produces our confession. It produces our faith response. Remember sin, Romans 14, verse 23, part B. Anything that is not of faith, anything that does not flow out of the trust relationship with God is sin. But when you behold the Lamb of God, the sacrifice of our Savior, when you see how much God loves us, laying down his life for us, it creates within you a trust of God, a confidence in God, a faith in God, and we are saved by his initial grace that produces our responding faith. The Bible is trying to tell us that God acts first. There's a young lady coming to a close who's admittedly getting a little older, and she would like to be married, and for whatever reason the right relationship is eluding her. She's been engaged before, but she knew deep down inside wasn't the one. And all of a sudden God arranged some things, and someone that has communicated with her started to catch her eye and her attention. She found herself getting excited. She said, oh, this might be it. And I counseled her and said, do nothing. Don't call him. Don't email him. Don't text him. And above all, don't touch him. Just receive from him. Don't rebuke him.
Let him know you appreciate it. Let him know you enjoy it. But let him pursue you. And after he goes after you and grabs you and puts a ring on you, then you can dive on him. And ain't that how it works with God? He says that with loving kindness, I've drawn you. God wants you, desires you, is pursuing you. And your job is to respond to your Savior, to just fall in the loving arms of Jesus. And when you do, the end of this story takes place. Jesus said, "Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more." Was he giving her a new standard that was going to be almost as frustrating and humiliating as what she had previously encountered? Was Jesus requiring something of her that would be equally impossible? No, you all remember when Jesus said to that paralyzed man in Mark 2, "Take up your bed and walk." What was previously impossible, by God's power, had now been made possible. Jesus is saying, now that you've experienced my love and my grace, you have been empowered to sin no more. You have been equipped. You have been strengthened. It's not that I'm now commanding and demanding that you show your appreciation by in your own power sinning no more. No, she'd be right back trapped, told by elders before the church in worship if keeping the law was up to her. But the Bible said his name would be called Jesus, because he would save his people from, not with, not alongside, not hanging over the fence, still touching and tasting, but from. Our salvation is better than I first believed. He not only condemns himself instead of condemning us, but then he saves us so that we don't have to experience the condemning effects of sin. He pays the penalty and provides the righteousness. And I just want to say thank you, Jesus. Oh, I want to thank him for his grace and his mercy. Oh, God, your grace and your mercy, they brought me through. I'm living this moment because of you. And I just want to thank you and praise you too, because your grace and your mercy brought me through. I want to thank you for saving me. I want to thank you for raising me. I want to thank you for loving me. I want to thank you for dying for me. I want to thank you for strengthening me. I want to thank you for delivering me. I want to thank you for coming back to get me and not forgetting me. I want to thank you for helping me and holding me and changing me and transforming me. I want to thank you for renewing me and realigning me and restoring me and redeeming me. I want to thank you for being a good God, for being a gracious God, for being a merciful God. Does anybody else want to thank God? I want to praise God. I want to worship God. And if you give me your spirit, I'll obey you, God. I want to live for you. I'll even die for you. I want to serve you. Just want to see you. I'm thankful for the good news of salvation. And it's better than I believed. Anybody realizing that God, in the midst of your sin, executed your salvation? Anybody want to respond by admitting your need of a Savior, by confessing your desire to be cleansed? Anybody want to re-enter a relationship with God based upon the good news that He acts first? The altar is open. This is your opportunity. If you understand the good news that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us, if you understand it and you want to accept it, salvation is yours. Oh, He's responsible for enabling you to go and sin no more. That ain't your job description. He says He'll work in you to will and to do of His good pleasure. He said He who began a good work in you is faithful and able to complete it. He said He's the author and the finisher of your faith. Your job is just to respond to Him. Your job is just to put your trust in Him. Your job is just to believe Him. Your job is just to praise Him. Your job is just to surrender to Him. Your job is just to follow Him. Your job is just to thank Him for being the Savior that He is. Anybody want to accept the good news of the gospel? This is your opportunity. We're inviting you to come forward. You're saying, Jesus, I'm not trying to bring my sanctimonious. I'm not trying to bring my religious, legalistic righteousness that I've been creating. No, I'm coming because You paid my penalty and You said You'd provide my righteousness. We're inviting you to come right now. Our preachers are coming down to receive those who are responding to the gospel. We're praying a prayer of praise and thanksgiving. We are thanking God that individuals are accepting, believing in the good news. Oh, it's better than you thought, better than you imagined, better than you hoped for, better than you dreamed of. But you got to believe it and receive it. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes it, anybody believe that Jesus will do what He said He will do? Anybody believe that He paid your penalty? Anybody believe that He'll provide your righteousness? Then come receive this salvation. Won't you come? Won't you come? Come on, somebody sing that song for us. Help us out. Somebody needs to accept the gospel. Won't you come? Anybody want to fall in love with Jesus? Oh, it's a response to His love. You don't have to worry about keeping commandments. He said, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. And when you recognize how much He loves you, unless you resisted and rejected, you will respond in loving Him. Won't you come? I really believe with every fiber of my being, one of the reasons why Jesus has not come is because He said, this gospel of the kingdom must be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then the end will come. We have not been preaching this gospel. We've been preaching a works-oriented gospel. We've been preaching a my contribution gospel. We've been preaching a I have to act first, God. gospel. Why don't you come and receive the everlasting gospel? This is your opportunity. If you've already accepted the good news of the gospel, I invite you to stand and let God know that falling in love with him was the best thing you've ever done. If you need to accept this gospel for the first time, we invite you to give God your heart and one of these preachers your hand. If you need to re-embrace this gospel, you got off track, you got confused, we invite you to come back. The altar is open right now. Step out of your seat, come forward, and step out on your faith that Jesus has paid your penalty and that he'll provide your righteousness. The altar is open. Oh, come on, falling in love with Jesus. It'll be the best thing you've ever done. We're inviting you to come. You're accepting Jesus as your Savior. Nothing in your hands you bring, but to the cross you cling. You're just like that woman caught in your sins. But the Bible says that he did not come into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Hallelujah! Instead of condemning you, he condemned himself before you even asked. Won't you respond? Won't you allow him to give you a new heart and a new mind and a new spirit and cause you to keep his commandments and his statutes?
It's the best thing.
Oh, that somebody would allow the scales to fall off so that they might see the everlasting gospel. Jesus, we're praying that a revival of true godliness will take place as a result of the preaching and hearing and receiving of your gospel. More important than the Sabbath, than the state of the dead, than the sanctuary, than even the second coming, is the first move of God's gift of salvation. It will make the Sabbath a joy. It will give us hope when our loved ones are experiencing the state of the dead. It changes the sanctuary from an idealistic pie in the sky ideology into my Savior cleansing me, restoring me, and transforming me. And when I've accepted the gospel, I won't fear his coming, but I'll be looking forward to his coming. Church, family, home, I need you to know we're missing the gospel. This is the answer. This is the solution. Won't you accept it? Let's sing that chorus one more time. This is your opportunity to come. If you hear his voice, harden not your heart. Won't you come? Even you, Nicodemuses, need to be born again. Yes, you, elder. Yes, you, deacon. Yes, you, deaconess. Yes, you, Sabbath school superintendent. Yes, you, treasurer. Yes, you, preacher. Yes, you, conference worker. And the way to experience the new birth is to accept the gospel of Jesus Christ. We're praying, we're praying, we're praying.
Falling in love is the best thing that I ever had.
Every head is bowed, every eye is closed.
It's the best thing.
Grab the hand of the person next to you. Let's talk to Jesus together as a family. Oh, dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we want to thank you for the good news of the gospel. Father, we are so thankful that we don't have to save ourselves. Lord, it is so difficult for us to get out of the legalistic rut and mindset we've been in for years. We know that obedience and righteousness is important and essential. So we've tried to jump past the gospel and create righteousness ourselves. And we're going to stand before you in the judgment in fig leaves. When you lived a totally perfect life, surrendered to your Father 100%, maintained trust and faith, never deviated, and you offer us that robe of righteousness in exchange for our filthy garments. Your death paid the penalty of the past, and your life provides the righteousness we need for the present. You've done everything we need. Our job is to trust you. And you've even helped us with that. You've given us a measure of faith. You said faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. Lord, increase our faith first to believe that you really do love your children. Even when we sin, even when we fall, you still love us. And then help us to believe that you will transform us. That those sins that so easily beset us, that you will come and set the captives free. Oh God, we're praying that in this central area, we will experience the joy of salvation. Set us free, God. Allow us to fall in love with you. Then fill us with your Spirit. So we will joyfully tell somebody else about you. Lord, we thank you for the words that our ears have heard. We ask that you will bypass all of the foolishness of preaching, my eccentricness and idiosyncrasies, and allow just your word to remain. Have your way, God. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Somebody say amen. Somebody say hallelujah. Anybody thankful for the good news of the gospel? Praise the Lord.